Well, how old do you feel tonight? The age you feel might be worlds apart from the actual age you are. Well, at whatever age, I welcome you to the program Nightsounds. I'm Bill Pearce. Actually, our commentary and music tonight will have to do with mid-age problems. I remember when I was a little kid, I must have been around 10 or 11 years of age, I told my mom at dinner one night, "You know, someday I'm going to be 40 like you." She looked in horror at me. "Oh, Billy, no, not you. 40? I can't imagine you at 40. Well, I tell you, I'm long past 40 tonight. And somebody said that no age is as threatening as that which has a zero attached to it. Tonight's program, I've titled Halfway There. That's what I usually tell older people when they say, "Well, I'm having another birthday, I'm going to be 60 or 65 or even 50. I say, "Well, you're halfway there. You've got a long way to go yet." But it really depends on how we feel, doesn't it? Well, I have some music on turntable one here that should regress your age a bit. The happy side of life? What would that be? The Otis Skilling's Orchestra getting us off and running here on our musical agenda with a little song entitled The Happy Side of Life. A representative of the American Institute of Family Relations said, "In our 20s, we acquire a family. In our 30s, we acquire things. In our 40s, we acquire anxieties." And I guess most of us measure our march through life with birthdays. As I mentioned a moment ago, no birthdays thrill us or threaten us more than those with a zero attached to them. 10, 20, 30 come as stepping stones to maturity. 70, 80, 90 stand as milestones to a triumphant old age, but 40, 50, 60 hang like millstones around our necks. Tonight's program, Halfway There, we're going to be addressing some of the problems that we face at various stages in our lives. Tonight I thought I might play two versions of the same song as rendered by two different male vocalists. Let's hear what they have to say about this progress through the ages.
Since I started for the kingdom, since my life he controls, since I gave my heart Jesus, the longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. The longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. The more that I love him, more love he bestows. Each day is like heaven, my heart overflows. The longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows.
Young man by the name of Michael Redman singing there. The longer I serve Christ, the sweeter he grows. Now, as I mentioned a moment ago, I want to bring in another man singing the same song, and he'll continue in the second stanza. Let's hear what he has to say.
Every need he is supplying, plenteous grace he bestows. Every day my way gets brighter, the longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. The longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. The more that I love him, more love he bestows. Each day is like heaven, my heart overflows. The longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. The longer I serve him, the sweeter he
There we heard two renditions of the same song by two men quite different in their ages. Poles apart, actually, but of the same mind as they once again sang the song, "The Longer I Serve Christ, the Sweeter He Grows." Michael Redman, beginning our sequence there, and George Beverly Shea was the one who sang just a few moments ago. So really, when it comes right down to it, age should not be that much of a factor. There are a few little things that I notice that come with age, but I tell you, I'm looking forward. And I really, other than the few little physical things I mentioned, never felt better in my life. I run 3 miles as often as I can, at least every other day, do 40 to 50 push-ups a day, 60 sit-ups, and this is not a show-off type thing. It's as I ran this morning on my return lap, I said, "Lord, the reason I'm running is not as an ego trip. I know I feel better, but it's so that I might be the very best for you that I can be, not only in my physical demeanor, but with the gifts you've given, speaking, singing, playing the trombone, a little writing, interacting with people, whatever it might be that you have bestowed upon this servant of yours. May we be the best, working at optimal performance. And I am no hero, folks, I'll tell you that. It's something that any and all of us could do, no matter what our age is." I was reading an interesting observation the other day. Physicians seem to have particular difficulty traveling through the midlife period. The rate of physician suicide is at least 1.5 to 2.5 times greater than for matched groups of other professionals. Most physician suicides occur between the years of 35 and 54, during a physician's most productive years. And this only represents the tip of the iceberg of physician dissatisfaction. And we really can't explain that away on the basis that doctors have easy access to medications, because pharmacists, who have drugs more readily available to them, take their lives less frequently. But physicians, it seems, go through long periods of delayed gratification to acquire their education. Yet midlife is no respecter of persons. men and women who wear the trappings of success in our culture sometimes appear most deeply affected. But we don't have to surrender to this so-called syndrome of the midlife. Some even attest to the fact that it doesn't exist, this midlife crisis factor. But evidently, it doesn't spring from a single cause when it does exist. Instead, it represents a cluster of physical, psychological, spiritual symptoms that occur in most men, sometimes between 40 and 50. And I understand that only recently there's been a realization that adults, like children, go through stages in development. From the ages of 16 to 22, for instance. And during this half decade, youthful fantasies about adulthood begin to fade. Young people feel the influence of peer groups, encouraging them to break the mold, break the hold of the family, and get into group beliefs and standards. Emotions are held in check for the most part, and friendships are tentative. Any disagreement by a friend tends to be considered disloyal. Usually by the ages of 23 to 28, we get into the adult world. At 18, I felt restive. I wanted to leave home and establish some sort of an identity and momentum on my own. Back there was a world war going on, so we were swept into the service of our country. Didn't have much of a choice. But usually around the ages of 23 to 28, this is a time when a young man has broken away from his home. He feels independent. Wonders what he'll be, what he'll major in. From 29 to 34, for the most part, an adult is settling down into the adult world, and crises begin to develop at this stage. I went through it at age 40, and it seemed to continue for about 5 to 8 years. A dissatisfaction, an inner unrest about my progress in life. Where have I come so far? At what stage should I be? What is life all about? For many, assurance wavers. Life appears more difficult and troublesome. Hard questions demand answers. In our culture, where women seek a career, a young woman may also ask that question. If a girl has been totally dependent on her parents, she can encounter difficulty as she leaves those close to her and tries to establish her own identity. Dr. Haddon Robinson, in his fine book Mid-Life, said some young women go directly from parents who make all decisions to a husband who seems to make all the decisions and are stifled because they have made few independent choices themselves before marriage. The active social life of the 20s tends to diminish and marriages may suffer strain. Dr. Robinson said some men, especially those who married early, may come to regard their wives as obstacles to success. Valiant points to a crassness and a callousness. Materialism come at this time. It's not only the early 30s, however, that a person starts to settle down. A guy may do this with enthusiasm, misgivings, or blind resignation. Most men involved in research, kept their mentors until the next stage, which began somewhere between 35 and 39 years of age. Dr. Robinson said from 35 to 45, at this point, a feeling of being constrained in their professions or businesses may arise. Many begin to break out into a new kind of life, one of freedom and of working on their own terms. For a wife and mother, the 40s may bring strangeness of the empty nest. If a woman has seen her role as that of a mother and little else, then when children go off to college or get married, she has a letdown. She may wonder whether life really has lost its purpose. And along with her husband, she may stumble through this dark wood of midlife crisis. Tonight's program, Halfway There, will suggest that we need not give in to this. It may sweep over us, our emotional cycles may come in like a flood. But somewhere, if there can be that love brought to the front burner again, if two people can begin to realize that they're having problems, a wife may see her husband emptily gazing out the window, not entering into conversations, going off by himself. It would probably be good for her, even with her own problems, to be sensitive to this and begin a conversation, to reaffirm her love to him, to keep herself in good condition physically and emotionally. And the husband to do the same for the wife. Tonight's program, Halfway There. I'd like to live to be 100. I heard an adult say the other day, not me. I don't want to stay in this world any longer than I have to. When we have that kind of an attitude, all of a sudden things begin to take on a similar kind of hue. Things look negative. We lose our perspective of positives, and we can become embroiled in the vortex of those which just take us right down to obscurity. This does not need to happen, and it's a matter of choice, not of heroism. To know love, if you live alone, perhaps you don't know a physical, emotional love readily available. But in any situation, in any age, the love of Jesus Christ is our fortifying factor. I'd like to play a song now by Cynthia Clawson that speaks of the miracle of love, what it can do. All I need to know is love at any age, and it's life-giving, delivering. Let's hear what she has to say to all of us at any stage.
Look at my face. I know the years are showing. And look at my life. Still don't know where it's going. I don't know.
Cynthia Clawson, the song, All I Need to Know. This is Night Sounds. I'm Bill Pearce with you, and our program tonight, halfway there, is dealing with age and midlife crises and things that we meet along the way as we move ahead. I'd like to hear what you think about it. Many of you have gone through this before and can give good counsel. If we can help you in any way beyond the program you're hearing, this is our desire. Our mailing address, Night Sounds, Wheaton, Illinois, 60189. Dr. Haddon Robinson, whom we're quoting tonight, said a man needs to have two friends of the same sex. When he says my wife is my best friend, he often means my wife is my only friend. But a wife can't carry the entire burden. A man will be greatly benefited if he can pour out his feelings, chaff and grain together, and know that a dedicated friend will separate them and help him see the difference. And a woman needs the same. Jesus declared that we must have a whole-souled relationship with God. This makes all the difference in the world. In any crisis we face in our lives, whether it be midlife, that within, or without marriage, the common things that come and hit us broadside to one degree or another, physical problems, emotional, mental, financial. These all befall the human race. We need outside help. We need a spiritual dimension to carry us through that. I just counseled with a person this morning advising this person to relate this to God while we take care of the logistics of survival. Without a center, a Christ center, a God center, the vacuum would quickly overtake us. Jesus says, "Come to me, all of you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Learn of me, take my yoke upon you, trust in me. Peace I leave with you, not the peace of the world. My peace I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled." At midlife, adolescence, the later years, God is there, and He's the same yesterday, today, and forever, and He's going to carry you through. This too shall pass. You're going to make it. Thank you for sharing these moments tonight. I very much appreciate you and respect you and what you have to say. Look forward to meeting you, perhaps on a concert weekend. If we can be a part of that particular service in your life, let us know. Our mailing address, Nightsounds, Wheaton, Illinois, 60189. Well, time marches, doesn't it? And here we are at the termination of another Nightsounds together. Until we meet again, then, may God go with you through the years to the very end of joy with Him. And until we meet again, a peaceful good night.